this week's edition of the Phantom Zone podcast, the event we've waited for all year, the invasion of the Dominators. We saw all four shows come together, Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, Legends of Tomorrow, all into one glorious beat-em-up, mashup, universe crossover, spectacular, and man, was it awesome.
We were not people. That was not pre-planned. That was all him just talking.
Yeah, we definitely didn't do a take before this.
Yeah, not at all. We didn't get a practice run that was dropped out via internet. Anyway.
This is total spontaneity.
Yes. This whole week of TV was great.
Yeah, it was, I liked it a lot.
It was a really good Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode.
Thanks, Alan.
That's what I was watching before this.
Alan,
I mean, he's not wrong. I saw it, too. It was actually pretty good.
Yeah, and before we get into it, we are dropping Supergirl this week just because none of us actually remember it. Crossover stuff.
Crossover supersedes priority.
Right.
Well, yeah, the majority of the conversations we've put that stuff anyway, and I don't know. Having the end of the episode be the only crossover bit was a bit weird, but okay.
Yeah, and I cannot tell you a single thing that happened during it.
Something Medusa, and it didn't work, and then people were upset or something. Manhunter.
Hank Henshaw died for good.
Yeah, he did.
And Alex came out to his mother.
No, he didn't.
No, Hank Henshaw died.
He disappeared, remember?
Oh, wait. This is why we're not talking about Supergirl this week, because I do not remember what happened.
So, yeah, like, he was, like, on the ground, and then they, like, turn away for a second, and then he's gone, and we're like, oh, well.
And that was Supergirl.
Right. Stuff happened.
Basically, and then at the end of the episode, Barry and Cisco breach into her apartment, and then that's kind of where we get going.
Get a little preview of Petty Cisco, and then...
Holy, okay. I'm going to get this right
away. Yes, get it over with.
Fuck Cisco right up until Thursday. Holy, I was so annoyed with all this, like, this petty, bitter, shitty friend Cisco. I'm glad it's over.
Should I burn the vibe trade that I have?
Oh my god, he was pissing me off.
It was so annoying. Like,
it was incredible. It was unbelievably forced.
Like,
you got.
I don't understand.
Did any of you guys?
I don't understand what he's upset about at this point.
Barry,
like,
killing his brother.
Well, I could have sworn earlier this season that they already crossed this bridge of, like, Cisco somehow finding out that through time travel, like, Dante died. Yeah. And then he kind of, like, got over it. And then all of a sudden, someone brings it up again. He's like, nah, fuck you, Barry. And just goes right back. I'm like, okay, so much for progress.
Yeah, last week's episode.
And, like, everyone, all these, like, throughout the crossover was like, you might want to, you know, give Barry some slack. He's like, no!
Yeah. I don't want to. He's like that picture of the otter with, like, the squirt gun. You see that picture? It's hilarious.
Did you guys see the meme of Daniel Pennebaker and Carlos Valdez?
Yeah, that was really good.
When you're petty as fuck.
No, it's like when you're trying to be hold it in or something, and your best friend killed your brother, or while your even though your best friend killed your brother, something like that.
I did see that one. I think that was one Owen put on my Facebook. But I'm glad it's over. And I think the only other complaint I had was the pace at which this all went down. But I guess that's just a necessity.
Yeah.
Like, the, there goes Hunter. Episode, the Arrow segment, where Mad Dog is like, I don't trust metahumans. Literally 3 minutes later, he's like, metahumans are all right.
Yeah, that was, like, that whole, like, thread, I didn't understand, like, where Mad Dog was coming from, because I don't know if Mad Dog has ever had any run-ins with metahuman.
Wild Dog, not Mad Dog. That's a different person.
I call him Mad Dog for some reason.
Mad Dog is a sports personality.
Yeah.
Did I call him Mad Dog?
No, Hunter did.
I did.
Okay, yeah, that's also an Arkham character, I believe, or a Batman character.
Mad Dog Harkins, or a fucking Flash.
So, yeah, like, that, the amount of stuff going on would hinder some of the like the speed at which things happen, but whatever, it's fine.
You know what else bothered me? This is my problem with Flashpoint in general, is that they refuse to explain anything that happened in Flashpoint other than what they don't show us enough of the changes, I don't think.
I was going to touch on this later, but I guess I'll just get it out of the way. Now that we have established that Barry did something that has universal effects, literally, like what he did caught the attention of a fucking intergalactic alien species, I think we need to start seeing more of what got affected.
Yeah.
Well, the Dominators are coming back, though.
Yeah, probably.
Probably.
No,
why
no.
isn't Supergirl on I mean, they are... Earth now? That bothers me, too.
Well, she's not. Which, I'm not happy about that. Especially since they said that she would just suddenly be there. They said that she would suddenly be in the same universe. And they kind of fixed it by saying, well, now she has a device that can take her to any universe she wants now.
No, it was only two there to Earth Prime.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess.
It just bothers me. That they just
they gave her a universal psychic paper.
They just refused to change anything. Yeah. Anyways, I really don't have many complaints. I mean, there was a few weird things, like we said, like Cisco
there's a couple instances just like characters I love just being dicks, like Stein, Oliver, and Cisco were all just like at some point just got super shitty and then just got okay.
Yeah,
what's wrong with Stein? it made me mad watching him. Was like, oh, I don't want a daughter. Like. Like, out of all things,
Dad, now I'm good.
I don't want a daughter.
I guess what bothered me the most is there were moments where each show became a different show, like completely. Like, most part, they all blended together and they kind of made like a soup. But there were like segments where like, oh, this is like Arrow right now. This is just pure Arrow, and it doesn't really work because it's like it's the ending of that Flash episode, but it's the Flash team doing Arrow, and there's very clearly a difference in how they do things, so they're not doing it as well. And the same thing happened at the end of Arrow. It's them doing Legends, but they're not quite as good at doing Legends as the Legends team is. So, and those moments happen throughout, and they really took me out of individual episodes. But it'd be like a chunk. It'd be like 1 minute where, this is like the way Arrow would handle this. But this is how Flash would handle this. And it doesn't feel disjointed.
Yeah.
Just a minute or two.
I mean, the entire sequence that I mentioned with Wild Dog, Flash, and Supergirl seemed very disjointed.
Yes.
It almost seemed unnecessary.
Yeah.
And I don't want to keep harping on this because I loved pretty much all of it, but like that who was that villain they took down in like
Cyberwoman?
I'm sorry, that is she is more disposable than Shade.
I know she's
she's not.
What a fucking joke!
She's not actually a character, like a comic character. She was created for the show, so that kind of shows how
still, she was only there. She was only there so Barry and Supergirl could basically double team suplex her into oblivion. And that's it.
Yeah. I mean, she should be dead, right? I immediately thought that.
Bring her back in Arrow season 6.
Well, I mean,
yeah, she did get like Barry hit her like full force running and then he whipped her into Supergirl, who then like clotheslined the shit out of her.
But yeah, again, she should be dead.
She'd be dead.
No, her head should have fucking flew off.
Should have fucking disintegrated.
She's a robot, cybernetic, whatever.
I don't care.
And
fucking,
the only reason why she was there is so they could take a little tiny micro transistor out of her arm.
Yeah, and it would have been a lot easier when Supergirl punched her and she disintegrated.
You know what the wiki said her name is?
What?
You know what her actual like her designation is, like her code name?
I think Cybergirl or Cyberwoman.
Cyberwoman. That's it. And she's just Cyberwoman, and that just made me laugh because I was just like, "What was
some
she called?"
Like some executive poking his head in, like, "Have him fight something, like a Cyberwoman or something," and then he just leaves.
She's like some sort of Cyberwoman.
She actually has a has ties to Cyborg.
She's like a Robo lady.
Right, that's what I heard.
Not the character from Invasion.
Right.
Or from Arrow.
Yeah, but that whole story...
An entirely different character.
Yeah, that whole thing leads to them finding out how to rescue the Arrow team.
But that's the middle of the... so I guess let's go to... What is this? One of them crash lands in Central City and Flash finds it?
Right.
No, then he gets not blown back. And he sees a bunch of aliens going past him, World War Z style.
And then we get weird, like, government hijinks in Flash, which was so weird.
Yeah. They've only really done it once before, and that was with the whole general guy.
Isling.
Yeah.
We covered Cisco being a big old dick.
Especially to Caitlin.
Yeah. How dare he?
Just go out and drink, dude. Like,
drown your problems with alcohol like the rest of us.
Right. Be a real man.
Drink some whiskey, put some hair on your chest.
Right.
I guess actually this would lead to us hearing Barry's message in its entirety.
Oh, wait, no. The only way that Cisco can actually be happy is by breakdancing. Thank you for getting that.
I don't get that at all.
Don't worry about it.
It's something that Vibe did. He is known for.
Yeah. I mean, based off these episodes, the only way he can be happy is if he's shitting on Barry's day. Like, fuck. I mean, we keep on harping on it, but it really was...
He was so fucking mean, like...
It was unwarranted.
He was unrationally, like you couldn't even talk to him like about it, because he just got so, like... it was something no one could have predicted or changed or helped. And, like, it's not like Barry put a gun to Dante's head and just blew him away. Like, it was incidental. And Cisco got super upset about it, like... He pouted for two straight episodes.
But
one point, he was like, "No, Barry straight up killed him." And then Felicity was like,
no, he didn't."
I did like the payoff to that, though.
And what I said the other day, I says, "I hope this petty Cisco thing ends soon." You're like, "I hope it's done by Legends," and lo and behold, it was.
Yeah, and I like the payoff a lot. I like that moment where he realizes, I've been a fucking dick this whole time, and it's really easy to do this. It's
really easy to make this kind of mistake and fuck with, like, the time-space continuum.
Right. It's not...
Damn it, Cisco. Instead of damn it, Barry.
Damn it, Barry.
Well, there was a bit of damn it, Barry.
The damn it, Barry resonated throughout the fucking galaxy so loud that aliens came and were like, damn it, Barry.
I love that that's the plot. I really love that. But they just came to Earth just to be like, damn it, Barry.
Damn it, Barry.
Now we gotta kill you.
Damn it, Bobby. Yeah.
I really like that, too. Like, their whole thing was Barry. And it wasn't something where they just want to terrorize the Earth. Or
no, it was kind of an I Am Legend thing where it was like, dude, you're fucking scary. Like, what do you think you're doing?
Right.
Knock it off.
Yeah. Cut that shit out.
Just stop.
You are a galactic threat.
Yeah. I like that line, we've done this before and we will do it again. That was a really good moment, I thought, the way that they played that.
But lots of interactions between lots of people. Almost 2 minute to count because we've seen these people so separated for the last 2 years now.
Can we talk about the real MVP, though? Mick Rory?
Skirt?
Hey, Skirt, call me.
I'm going to call you Skirt. Which then, like, immediately he backpedals on and then addresses her as Supergirl, which, again, showing that Mick is, like,
he's a pretty softy.
Cool guy.
Yeah.
He's a big softy, see, really.
Yeah.
He had a lot of moments where I was like, why are they setting up his character so much? Like,
because of next week? That's why.
I know the reasons why. I mean, like, he has these moments sometimes where they're just like they're building him up to something, and I'm like, I hope he doesn't die like Stark did, because that seems kind of cheap doing that twice in a row.
There'll be no more rogues left.
I honestly don't know if I'd go on without Heatwave and Captain Cold, because
those are definitely my favorite characters, like, and if they just kill off Heatwave, I would seriously consider not watching these shows anymore. Like,
personally, I think if anybody's disposable, it's Steel, believe it or not.
Yeah.
I mean, here's the thing,
We thought of the same way about Rip Hunter, though. Like, we thought he was disposable, and look at that. He's not even on the show anymore.
Yeah, but he's still cool, though.
He'll be back.
Yeah. As a little baby. He'll be a little...
throwback.
It'll be a special episode made by the people behind Muppet Babies.
No, there's already, I think, photo surface of him on the set in costume and everything.
No, he has a goatee. Just a goatee.
Yes.
Is that the change that he was talking about?
Yeah.
No clothes or anything, just a goatee.
I'm all different now.
It'd be funny if they just wrote to Marvel and just said the all new, all different Rip Hunter.
Just don't even care.
I did love when she said the Mightiest Heroes line at the very end.
Yeah.
Which I thought that was them calling out Marvel. It felt like it, kind of. Maybe calling it Marvel TV. I don't know.
Speaking of favorite lines, Brandon Routh had a great line.
She looks like my cousin.
She looks like my cousin. I was not expecting a Superman Returns reference.
I mean, I was. I just didn't know when. I was like, oh, when are they going to do it? Fake Iron Man and give him a good line. Regarding Supergirl being
And another good line that I really loved that made me laugh was, he followed your advice all the way to Pound Town. That's a good one.
Who said that one?
Jax.
Jax to Stein.
Oh, okay.
When Stein's explaining why.
When he was, when they went to 87 and he said that he was neglecting Clarissa.
Holy shit, how'd I miss that line?
It's weird. Fucking great.
If anybody's the voice of the audience for this show, it's him.
It's Jax.
Jax.
Diggle. I'm sorry. Diggle seems to always want to point out the weirdest shit. I love... Diggle was killing me, too, in the earlier episodes. Barry, my life was somewhat normal before you showed up.
Yeah.
I do love Diggle. Like, I didn't like Arrow before, but now all these characters are growing on me, and I don't know what to do.
Although this season of Arrow, aside, has revitalized my interest in the show entirely.
Yeah, it's good. I like it again.
It drew season high ratings.
Yeah. I mean, that 100th episode, if we were to talk about it just as a 100th episode, I shouldn't have liked it. I shouldn't have. It's a plot that's been used a billion times in genre TV. Like, I hate the whole, we're actually in a dream world thing. This is just so we can revisit old sets. And
I think what the characters walk away from it with was the most valuable thing that we could have gotten out of it.
Definitely. They used it well.
Yes.
As I wrote on the Haro, please visit it.
Visits.
Compared it to JLA, the JLA and Avengers crossover, where they, they're in this, like, parallel, or they're in this, so it's sort of like a dream world.
Dream thing.
Yeah. But they're shown, they're shown what their futures are.
Oh.
If they're given the option to either stay in their perfect world, or go back into the real world where Hal is dead, Barry's dead. This was in 2003, way before Flash Rebirth or Green Lantern Rebirth.
Right.
JLA Avengers was in 2003?
Yeah.
Wow.
I did not know that.
Yeah. That was from the 90s for some reason.
There was a crossover in the 90s also, I think.
Yeah, that's the Amalgam shit comes from, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I said before, all the interactions between all these long separated characters were, it was like a family reunion. Like everybody got together and they started just bullshitting, and they went over Snart real fast, which was awesome.
I loved that didn't even bother to say anything about Tommy. They just said that he's on Chicago Med.
Yeah, I love that. That was great, and also it's a in-show way of saying, oh no, he's not Prometheus. He's definitely not Prometheus.
Oh, that's right, because he had the vision right before he leaves the simulation, right? Of everyone who's kind of like come and gone in the Arrow universe.
Roy, his parents.
Yeah, I love that moment too. I mean, that moment and the fight right before then is really good.
Okay, was that the fight that the producers were hyping up as like the most intense, violent thing ever?
I think that they were talking about back when Corey What's-His-Face was on. I think that's what they were talking about. When he, like, slashes his tendons and shit.
Oh, okay.
I think that's what, because, like, they show slashing his tendons open, which is like a Hannibal thing, almost.
Yeah. I think this fight happened, I was like, well, yeah, it's important because of who's in it, but I was like, as a fight, it wasn't that spectacular.
I still liked it a lot. I was, of course, disappointed because that wasn't Slade. That was like half of Slade.
There's a lot of leg mutilation in the Arrowverse.
That was just a sun guy in a suit.
Yeah, like if they wanted to bring back Slade, you bring back Manny Bennett. That's how you bring back Slade and have him say something really cheesy and incredibly awesome.
It was Dream Slade
when he showed up. He just showed up and just disappeared.
It's Dream Slade.
Yeah, he's a simulation.
Yeah, so it's kind of like there's
no... He didn't do anything, he just showed up.
Yeah, he just showed up to fuck with Ollie.
Yeah, same with Malcolm. He was just there playing on their errand.
One purpose, he wasn't actually there.
I have a question. Did he die in, like, in the previous season of Era?
No, he's on Leon U right now.
Oh, he got locked up?
Yeah, have you not seen season 2 of Era?
You mean season 4?
No, season 2 is when he was, like, the lead villain.
You mean season 1.
Slade?
No, I'm talking about Malcolm.
Oh, I was talking about Slade. Malcolm is season 1. Last I saw, he survived. I think he's...
Isn't he...
He's on Legends this season, so he's coming back.
Yeah,
but in the present...
Isn't he, like, the Rasha Razagul?
No,
he got his hand cut off.
Yeah, and the League was disbanded.
Yeah, Nyssa disbanded it.
I have a bet going about when Merlin's going to show up in Legends tomorrow, and I swear to God he's going to be on the last episode.
Maybe.
That would really like go hand in hand with me thinking they're dragging this Legion of Doom thing way out.
Yeah.
Well... If you checked if you checked the Harrow, I broke down the what could possibly be for episode 12, which is Camelot / 3000, and that's based on a Mike Barr and Brian Bolland comic when King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table go to the year 3000 and they. Morgan Le Fay is there leading an alien invasion.
Just give me Etrigan and I'll be happy.
What the fuck?
Merlin's there. Mordred.
Oh.
Just give me Etrigan. I don't care.
We are way off topic.
Yeah, let's bring it back to this.
That would imply that we were on topic at one point.
We've been on topic this entire time. You hush.
But yeah, that last night.
Quiet, Chris.
Fine. I'll go and turn off my thing and go listen or watch League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
I mean, sure.
Chris, we're all going to murder you someday. You know that.
Don't worry. Don't worry, I'm aware.
That's going to be the last episode. It's us.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm in my room watching League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, and then you all storm through the door with axes.
Yep.
It's
going to be like, you're like,
no, you're not.
Good, you're going to be in a bar. We're all going to sneak up behind you. One of us is going to say, you caught me, and then one of us stabs you in the neck. And then we.
Yeah. But that would imply I actually go out.
Well, we're.
I don't leave my house. I'm
all right, fine. We'll come to your bedroom. Just like more. You know, just.
Chris, do not take away my Goodfellas-inspired murder, okay?
Break down your goddamn door. Anyway, where were we?
Yeah.
Everybody being chummy.
Yeah. We did a real emotional stakes in that Arrow section. I really liked it. They made, again, a plot line that has been used in every genre show ever. I mean,
Friends did it, didn't they?
I mean, yeah, it even went beyond genre, didn't it? Like, just, you have a dream sequence so you can save money and just put them in one set for, like,
a fill episode slot, put them in a dream sequence.
Are you kidding me? Scrubs defined this genre, like, this TV trope, like, 100 times over.
But they used it so well, so.
Yeah.
I thought they used it really well. Like, last time I can think of it being used this well was, like, Supernatural when they did it. Like, I've never really seen it done that well since. So, yeah, really well done. I remember thinking, is this I'm just trying to save money for the Legends in the Flash section of this? And is this just time-saving thing? But no, they really used it to its full effect. So I thought it was a job well done. I thought everything outside of the dream sequence was really the weak point of this section of the crossover.
Yeah, like we already said with Cyberwoman. We did get, I think before, during this, we finally got some Kid Flash.
Yeah, yeah. And even, that was my least favorite part of the Flash episode. Like, even though it felt like a real Flash subplot, I didn't like how it blended in with the rest of it. But, yeah.
Question, though, how did Barry fire off three shots of lightning?
Speed Force.
I'm doing jazz hands right now. Okay.
He's got amazing hand control.
It's fucking magic.
it actually at one point was magic.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. He did it three times. What do you want? This is a show where there's a woman who can fly between universes, and there's a guy who can shrink down to the.
I'll say the amount of ridiculous things on display in these three episodes, and Alan's like. How did Barry throw three lightning bolts instead of one?
Yeah.
It's a valid question.
Your real question should be, why didn't it affect Supergirl? Because we know, in her universe, Kryptonians are affected adversely by electricity.
No, your real question should be, why does Arrow shoot people in the leg so often? Yeah. It's the one thing I can't get over. I don't know what it is. I just see it, and I'm like, why does he keep doing that?
Man, he even shoots his partners in the leg.
Yeah. He mentions how he shot Barry.
I don't know. He's a Skyrim player, guys.
he just really
no adventures for you. We did get that big hero brawl, everybody. Speaking of that, actually.
Yeah.
Which I guess was bound to happen because whenever superheroes like, can we get a superhero crossover event where it? Civil War aside, because that was the intention, can we get a superhero event where it doesn't devolve into everyone fighting for whatever reason?
I mean, that's what... Okay. The reason that happens is because marketing's like, well, everyone wants to see them fight. And honestly, I really don't want to see them fight.
I don't want to see them fight because it's... Unless someone's going to die, it's pointless.
Yeah, like... I want more of that end scene with just him and Oliver at the bar. I loved that.
Yeah, I think people mistake, this goes back to something that I have a problem with comics in general. I think I don't like constant conflict, between heroes and, stuff like that.
What's with the Cisco thing was bothering me so much. I'm like, you realize I have to put up with him for the rest of the season, right? And if he doesn't get any better, I'm going to be really turned off.
Yeah.
It's the relationship between these characters is far more interesting than tearing them apart.
Yeah. We don't need to be season one Foggy or whatever.
Yeah.
Suppose meaning
Foggy's the best, all right?
Foggy became the best.
Yeah.
And in season when 2, killed him far better than season
that's, 1. And I was comparing Foggy and Sisko while this was all kind of happening. I'm like, yeah, but the worlds they come from are way different, and Foggy handled it way different.
Yeah.
Foggy still was like, Matt, you're my friend, but, like, I'm really worried about you, and, like, I can't believe you lied to me. Sisko's like, friends? Fuck you, Barry.
What about me?
What about me?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah, but they resolved the Sisko stuff really well. Overall, I thought the Dominators were really well done.
Their design is...
They look
really strong.
Exactly the way Tom McFarlane drew them.
Yeah, they look great. Like,
their big ass teeth.
Yeah, their teeth is like that's a holdover from the comics. Like they had the yellow and red head and like the crazy like fangs.
Although I could have gone without one of them going on a monologue.
Yeah,
that was some silly shit.
I mean,
only because it couldn't sound more like a 1950s sci-fi movie.
But wasn't that kind of
if this wasn't in the middle of an alien invasion, it'd be hokey as fuck.
Yeah,
this whole this is something I was kind of thinking about throughout this whole thing. It's like this is kind of cheesy, but it was the right kind of cheesy. Like.
Mm-hmm.
The alien, they kidnap the president at the start of it.
And
like,
then immediately murder him.
They immediately kill the president.
It's pretty great.
And I was like, okay, I'm on board.
They're like some of the most effective aliens I've ever seen. Like, they show up and then immediately kill the president, and they're just like, alright, yeah, let's move on.
Which is kind of weird, because like, the whole plan
it
was...
It took the Martians from Mars Attacks like 90 minutes to do that.
Yeah.
Their whole plan was to kill Barry and the president.
They killed the fucking president. No, they don't kill anyone else.
They don't just kill him. They disintegrate him.
Destroyed him.
No, they gooed him, I mean.
Oh, yeah.
The way he, like, disintegrated made me laugh, too, because, like, the way the camera cut, it was just so fast, and it just made me laugh.
It's like the Ant-Man shit, where he just turned to goop.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was the right amount of cheese, I think, like...
Yeah.
Especially the Legends episode, and I find that the Legends of Tomorrow are very cheesy, like...
Yeah.
What's his name? Citizen Steel, even his suit is, like, cheesy.
Oh, God, he looks like a Comic-Con, like...
He looks like someone's cosplaying Citizen Steel.
Right.
Like...
His costume reminded me most of the comedian from the movies.
Yeah, I can see that.
Also, I don't know why it stuck out to me so much, but I really want a superhero thing, not counting Kick-Ass, where I don't blatantly see that someone colored in around his eyes.
Yeah.
Even big old raccoon eyes.
I mean, I think where it was most noticeable was on Thea, like, or
Thea?
Who the fuck? The Red Hood girl, whatever. Speedy. I can't remember.
Yeah.
Speedy. Yeah.
Yeah, Thea. Said Thea, and it bothers me.
Oh, sorry.
Thea
Sam's a robot.
And then when people pull their masks off, they immediately pull them at the,
guys,
the black makeup on, too.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of which, we got Arrow Diggle.
Oh, yeah. I thought that was really... Well done.
So what is Diggle's Green Arrow origin story?
He's guilty. Feels guilty about
the war.
Yeah.
Oh.
Rip. So he did something. Like, it's as if his brother came back to Starling City and was angry about what he did. That's how I read that.
Oh, like, okay. That kind of makes sense. I can see that.
Yeah. So he probably worked for Hive in that alternate universe, I might guess. Yeah. Dream timeline.
I legitimately thought that was Connor Hawk.
Yeah, that would have
been. I was so excited. They're finally going to do it.
And as much as I don't like her, it was good to see Laurel again.
Yeah, she was really good. And guess what she didn't do the entire time? Put on a leather outfit and beat people with a billy club. She was just Laurel. Really well. She was playing, like, the emotional heartstrings. And, yeah.
I also really liked Katie Lott's, any scene she had with Oliver, I really liked. Just seeing them on screen together again was kind of awesome.
Yeah, it was really good. They
especially their line about this whole thing start to think this whole thing started with us on.
The oh yeah, Gambit.
Yeah, that was really good too.
I have a question. Did Ray Palmer get a new Adam suit?
Yeah.
Is it the same one?
No,
it's the same exact suit. It's just replicated.
Yeah, he made.
I don't remember that visor. Like,
he always had a visor.
Like, yeah, I don't think I've ever noticed the visor before.
Yeah, it's always been there. It can change shape. It
looked bulkier for some reason.
It did look a little different, I guess. I don't know if they made any big changes, because there's the scene with Sisko where he says, I feel like you might be in need of an upgrade, which is obviously them saying, well, Sisko's going to design something new for him. It's not going to be a cool one, which is him in a leather jacket, just wearing a t-shirt, shrinking like a shrinking dude, but whatever.
I want the actual Adam suit.
Yeah.
Not Star Store Iron Man.
But just make it black and have him wear a trench coat. I just want a guy with a trench coat. It's not obvious.
Because Rip Hunter's dead.
A Rip Hunter, he's not dead.
He's regenerated.
Maybe.
Yes, honey, yes. Yes.
There's a Doctor Who reference.
That was good.
Yeah, I mean, I can make another Doctor Who reference. This felt like Day of the Doctor to me in a lot of different ways. So. The tone of it is very similar. It's very celebratory of this whole universe. I mean, I feel like it could only be more celebratory if, like, Constantine had showed up and other of our tertiary.
Oh, God, if that happened, oh, my.
Constantine shows up and he looks right at the camera and just goes, fuck Gotham, and then just turns back around and everything else.
No, then they just end the show. God, yes. I need, like, a mini short or whatever that is, just like...
Yeah.
It's just him, Slow Ryan, saying, fuck Gotham.
God. Yeah. I mean, that could be the only complaint, is we complained about how he wasn't in this, because I feel like he could have.
Yeah, he could have. He's technically in the Arrowverse, so yeah.
There's been a lot of... That's another thing, like, that I just thought of. Where was, like, Martian Manhunter and all those, like...
He's in the other world.
I understand that.
68, I believe, is the number they gave him.
But think about next year, if they do another... Well, they're going to do another crossover.
I mean, yeah, they're going to do another crossover.
Oh,
like, it's inevitable. But
yeah,
they have Superman, right. Martian Manhunter, Miss Martian, like... Next year, if they don't use any of those characters, interesting.
We are dangerously close to having a TV Justice League, like, proper.
Yeah.
That we got several full-on Hall of Justice shots. Can't believe we haven't touched on this yet.
Yeah.
If it was shown once, I'd be like, that's a throwaway thing. They established this building and lingered on it, like, 7 times.
Yeah. Here's the thing. With Supergirl on another Earth.
Earth 38.
Earth 38.
That was an interesting thing to throw out. Alan, I'm just going to assume you looked it up.
No, I just remember. I remember Sisko saying it.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, I know, but I'm asking if any of us is going to look up what Earth 38 is in the proper... DC Universe. Have you done that?
Or do I really care?
As I was saying, Superman is in another Earth. Martian Manhunter is in another Earth. Like, they need to, like, close the gap, I think. Like, it goes back to my earlier point that I'm very disappointed that she's just not in the same universe, technically. Like...
Yeah, I can live with it.
And you know, it may just be me being an annoying fanboy. It's like, I just really want her to just exist in that world. Like,
yeah, I know. I think the problem is, I think they're going to do Crisis. I thought that they were going to do Crisis for a long time.
Oh, there's no way they're not going to do Crisis.
And I was thinking, my God, are they going to do it in Arrow Season 10? And that was before Supergirl.
It has to be after, like, the, Barry and, like, all of them kind of just, like, kind of grow up, in a sense. I think that as soon as, like, they're all like, oh, everything, like, we're all, like, full-fledged superheroes now.
But I feel like they might move it up sooner because of Supergirl. Like, I think her being here might have us at a crisis by Flash Season 5. Like,
that's entirely possible.
I mean, we're on Flash Season 3, and we've already done Flashpoint, so.
Yeah.
Right. So, I just looked up Earth 38, and that is with Captain Atom and the Atomic Knights.
Oh.
So, that's an Earth that no one can give a shit about.
Yeah.
They picked the right one.
And that is one that is an existing Earth in DC right now.
Okay. Yeah. There is one scene that really, like, I hate love it, and it's the scene with Ollie and Flash in the Zero Room, I think it's called.
Oh my god. I
can't remember what it's called. But whatever.
The time vault?
It's the time vault, yeah. fucking Oliver Queen just going, I would do it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, this is actually, I do love the scene where, like, it's when Oliver Queen, prone to violence, somewhat explosive, kind of irrational, is being the voice of reason.
Right.
Yeah.
But at the same time, he's still being kind of irrational, because he was just like, why the fuck are you, like, mad about this? You changed people's lives.
Yeah.
Well, then he backs up. He's like, dude, you're not God. He's like, stop worrying about all of this. Like,
which is very un DC like, because the whole the Justice League are supposed to be basically the gods.
Right. Gods pretending to be men, and Marvel is men pretending to be gods.
Yeah.
And I thought most of that was really good until he started like summarizing all of Arrow.
Yeah. Well, Oliver Queen basically just sits there and goes, why not me? Why not me?
Yeah. And, I didn't like that part, though. Like, I get it. You're going to get a lot of Supergirl people watching this episode that never have watched it before. So maybe you're going to sell them on Arrow, but what are the actual chances of that?
Yeah.
Because they're going to watch the second season.
I feel like this is like the fourth time this season that Arrow or Oliver has specifically mentioned the phrase, I watched Slade Wilson stab my mother through the heart.
Yeah.
Was it the first time, though, that he mentioned all the stuff with his dad?
Yeah, he doesn't really talk about that much. Like, I don't even think he's told Felicity about that. Like, I'm trying to think of who he's told that to. And it's got to be White Canary, because he had to have told her on the island. I really cannot remember. And he must have told Diggle at some point. I feel like that's something he would have told him about. But I honestly don't remember. Like, he never
told specifically his mom. The whole shooting a crew member, then turning the gun on himself.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty fucked up thing to do. Like,
yeah.
It's a fucked up thing to, like, leave out. Like,
yeah, my dad committed murder before committing suicide.
Yeah. And it's something I had even forgotten about. Like, I remember when I first watched that first episode of Arrow, I was like, oh, shit. He's just not real. Is this the direction they're going with? And then the rest of that episode is up and down between super cheesy and super serious. So that's the entire first season of Arrow, just constant back and forth. That's just one thing I really didn't like, kind of, just the whole, I'm going to summarize everything that's happened to me, in case you are a new fan and you haven't been watching Arrow up until this point.
You also didn't like, not enough HR, or at least not enough Tom Cavanagh.
Yeah.
I love, okay.
I feel like they've written themselves into a corner with his character.
Yeah.
I love how he was like straight up talking to himself when Wally walks by, and Wally just doesn't acknowledge it.
Yeah.
He's like, what the fuck, you're weird, dude.
Although I'm glad they will be giving him something to do with Wally.
Yeah.
Because up until now, he's been kind of just lingering.
Yeah,
And again, like, people being shitty, like, every time he brings something up, Sisko is usually the one who's like, yeah, it's stupid.
Fuck you.
Fuck you, and all your ideas.
I really like Petty Sisko now.
Yeah.
He's
more redeemable than regular Sisko, that's for sure.
I don't imagine Sisko saying it. I imagine it the voice of the Mortal Kombat announcer.
Fuck you.
You suck. I'm glad he has something to do with Wally. Like I said, we did get to see Wally do something.
Where's Jesse Quick?
If only to get back at Earth 2.
Shooting back?
Yeah.
That is Earth 2.
Yeah, I guess she's basically the Flash of hers now, because Jay Garrick, Hunter Zalman, Zoom, Black Flash is gone.
Yeah. He's coming back, though.
Jay Garrick is coming back next week.
Oh, I can't wait. Cannot wait.
I'm trying to think about the bases we need to cover for this whole big thing, because...
Yeah.
I think it was dozens of tiny moments, and then, like, just the big narrative was, like, aliens!
Remember that Senator Kelly guy?
Yeah, he
was very... Oh, my God. Okay, he sucked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love what happened to him, though, in the end.
Yeah, his ending is pretty great.
Oh, yeah, Carr telling him off is great. But, one, he just... I don't know, he was... too over the top in his delivery, and I don't know, his younger self, I just really wanted to punch him in the face.
His younger self really looks like his older self, though.
His younger self kind of looked like what's his face from Daredevil.
Charlie Cox,
Fisk's buddy.
The one that Karen.
Dude is also.
Yeah, the one that Karen lights
Charlie
up.
Cox, really, Alan?
That one guy from Daredevil, you know, Daredevil.
No, it's
been a while since I watched it.
It's the guy that Hunter's waifu shoots in the eye.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rest in peace, Wesker. Or Wesley.
We just lost a subscriber.
Oh, Wesley.
Anyways, I had a point that I wanted to point out, but especially in the Arrow episode, when everyone at that dinner party, like, what was Adam's kind of like simulation? Like, he was just standing there?
And businessman.
Yeah, he's married to Felicity. So.
No, his fiance. Yeah. His Felicity's his fiance.
Yeah.
Oh.
Then he's like, "No, I would I had a fiance. Her name is Anna."
Yeah,
I just want to know when they're going to introduce Jean Loring.
Yeah,
when they have the shitty Iron Man knockoff show.
Right. God. Yeah. Adam continues to bother me, but that's a legend.
I really like Brandon Routh as Ray Palmer, and it sucks. He is just shitty Iron Man.
Yeah. I just like Brandon Routh.
More I see a Brandon Routh, the more I want, like, a Super Returns 2.
No. You can have that.
Fuck off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's such a good Superman, though.
That's all good and dandy, but I don't want another Superman movie where he pouts and doesn't throw a punch the entire time.
Yeah.
And he's not...
I should rephrase myself. I want a Superman movie with Brandon Routh again.
Okay. I would be okay with that.
Yeah, that's a better suggestion.
Superman Returns is 90 minutes of Brandon Routh lifting things over his head.
And also being a stalker.
And Man of Steel is 1.5 hours of Henry Cavill walking around.
1.5 hours? What movie do you see? That movie's like 2 hours and 20 minutes long. Don't undersell that length.
Yeah, that's it's
no, just, half just the movie.
Half the movie's in slow-mo.
That's like 10 minutes.
The other half is him actually doing stuff.
I mean, yeah.
The other half is Michael Shannon yelling.
Which is the best part of the movie.
Yeah.
It, Michael Shannon doing anything is the best part of any movie.
Where did you learn? A farm?
Okay, let's save Man of Steel talk for when we eventually have to do
anyway.
Man of Steel episode.
Oh, God damn it.
It's going to happen. We'll pair it for a DC movie with a DC movie that everybody actually loves.
That's going to be hard to find.
Yeah.
So, anyways.
Superman 3.
Get the fuck out of here.
I'm banning all.
You don't like Richard Pryor?
Okay, Richard Pryor took that job for the money. So I guess I like Richard Pryor.
That makes me like Richard Pryor more.
Yeah, I like him getting paid to pretend to type on it. Okay, that's a Superman 3 episode that, again, we'll eventually have to do.
Crossover.
Yeah, crossover. I mean, so I don't know if this episode actually met my expectations, I guess, but I had some pretty crazy expectations. I expected a really big, like, movie, but on a TV budget, I guess, and I really didn't get that till the end, but the ending is insane. Flash and Supergirl just running all over the planet, just, that was really cool. And I love Felicity's little moment, with the Flash or whatever, and then she says, "Oh, sorry, I meant go Flash and Supergirl." That was a funny.
Oh, it's a job for Supergirl, and so yeah. Like it's a job for Superman. And then, what about
me? And then they play the fucking oh, let's finally see who's faster. I'm like, that's the wrong fucking character.
I know, but Supergirl is Superman for these shows, so
it, I know. It
just like Green Arrow is Batman.
Yeah,
he is.
Yeah.
Up until they inevitably introduce Batman.
I really hope...
I can't wait for that, to have Oliver stand in a room with someone who's more angsty than he is. Just have Oliver be like, what's his problem? And everyone in the room be like, are you kidding? You're the one asking this question?
Yeah. I'm not interested in that moment when that happened.
They were really, really pushing the Batman thing on Ollie. Especially when they were talking about training. Because he's like, I shot Barry in the leg, and just like, you need to not hold back. I was like, why are you being such an asshole right now? You just met her.
That's just Ollie. That's just who he is.
That was the third person being a big old dick to people. He was a huge dick to Supergirl in the last episode, kind of for no reason.
She could break his spine if she wanted to.
She could freeze him to death by blowing on him, and he's like, you need to give me some fucking space. And she's like, what is your problem, dude?
Yeah. Her reaction is always the best, though. Just like, what?
Because Melissa Benoist is perfect.
I mean, she is the true waifu. Only because she could kill you if you said no.
And also, like, she's just Superman, but a girl. Like,
yeah. She's like, the best.
In terms of, like, adaptions of, like, one character to another, like how they're trying to do with Ollie with Batman, like, this one feels the most genuine, I think.
Yeah.
I'm really not looking forward to the musical.
Why?
I agree, mostly because I distaste musicals.
I like three musicals in the existence of musicals, and I can't wait for this.
I really hate musicals, too, but I just really want to see Music Master.
Also, Scrubs episode, musical, it's the best.
That's an exception.
Yeah, the only time they've ever done it on TV and I've liked it was the That 70s Show one. And I don't even like that one that much. Like, it's all right.
They did it on Buffy, too.
What the fuck is wrong with Joss Whedon?
I mean, here's the thing. If he did a movie that was a musical, I would be there, like...
Oh, you mean Dr. Horrible Sing-Along Blog?
No, like a movie, like a
proper, a movie, a real one.
Like, or if he did a Broadway show, and
that's kind of hard, Connor.
He co-wrote it with the songwriters from a.
I guess it's a film.
A lot of salt with that sentence.
My eyes are like burning a hole in my wall, my ceiling right now. Just I cannot contain the amount of angst I have towards you right now, because Jesus fucking Christ, was that salty.
Wow.
Wasn't even supposed to be that salty. Just the way it came out. I'm also very tired.
Yeah.
Is there anything else to cover on this? On this?
I mean, it's kind of like Doctor Strange that we were
three and a tenth.
You like this
order.
So much?
We can go back to talking about Joss Whedon for an hour.
No,
you won't. I will go to bed, and y'all knew that.
But it's kind of like Doctor Strange. Like, I liked it so much, I really don't have much I want to talk about. Like,
yeah,
good episode.
Like, there's a lot of like really good moments. Like, I don't know. Like, all my complaints are really, really small.
All my complaints are mostly character things, I think.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, and they were all resolved by the end of the Legends episode.
Yeah.
Yeah. Arrow played nice with Supergirl. Cisco stopped being a dick. Stein accepted his daughter.
Yeah. That was really beautiful.
What the fuck? I don't want a daughter.
Yeah. That was bothersome.
When someone was like, I think when he implied she wasn't a real person, I was like, okay. This is getting up really mean.
You're about to, like, offend a whole bunch of SJWs on the internet.
Like, that was, that got weird. It got really weird. But I did like the resolution to that. Like, his realization that him having a daughter is so much more impactful. That,
like, that's like the, like, if I went back in time and, like, I changed something. I just come back and I have a daughter now. I'm like, all right, this is cool. Whatever.
Well, I must have done something, right?
Yeah.
Stein acted like an animal got into his house at night and ate all this fucking bread. He was so upset.
You mean I had to feed this thing?
I was like, son of a bitch. Can't make any sandwiches now.
She even goes like, at one point, she's like, I went to MIT. And he's just like, he's still just like, what the
fuck? He's like, sure you did. I addressed all my complaints early in the show, though. Everything else, I fucking loved.
Yeah, like, I guess...
This is a good, it's kind of a good, like, Flash has been good to okay this season.
Yeah, it's been...
Nothing's really knocked me in my ass with Flash yet.
It's been semi-consistent. Like, the only real episode I didn't like was the monster episode with the giant monster.
It's because nothing happened.
Yeah, because nothing happened. Like,
that was the...
Even so, like, if
And then the Shade episode with everything involving Shade.
Yeah, that was not... That was That was a filler episode, for sure. And,
it just... This felt like a really good miniseries, and I really enjoyed it, and I wish...
Well, I feel like of the three shows, Flash is pushing, like, their core concept the least. Like, Arrow is kind of building on... Whatever the fuck it's doing for season 5, like the Prometheus stuff is getting kind of bigger and bigger.
God damn
Legends,
it!
Legends is building a fucking supervillain team, and Flash is just like finally met Savitar, got his ass kicked, and then we got an alchemy reveal, and then that's really like the only thing that has happened this season outside of the premiere. And like the premiere happened, and everything has just been kind of middle ground ever since.
So, I'm reading directly...
And I credit that immediately to the absence of the reverse Flash.
Mm. So, I'm reading Direct Current right now. And, looks
Are
like...
Are you that bored?
Yeah. Brian Choi's Adam suit looks similar, a lot like the Ray Palmer's Adam suit.
Yeah. I still don't like...
They could be, I don't know, that's not the first time something like that has happened, I guess.
Yeah, like, they like to draw inspirations from all kinds of places, but...
That, like, once a company gets married to a design, like, in one branch of their franchise, they're going to start spreading it around.
Yeah. And, their general tone for this entire universe is very New 52, and just as far as, like, technology, how they like to portray it. They like to make things look very real and very believable most of the time. So, yeah, that makes sense, I guess.
Except for Red Tornado.
Well, that's the CW.
Red Tornado's always
it's a CBS,
kind of like
so
iffy.
Yeah. Like, there's so many good little character moments that we could go through all of them and be here for, like, 5 hours. I love when Supergirl says, yeah, we could use an Oliver Queen in our universe. That was a really strong moment. And all those little moments.
Right? Is that an implication that he's dead in her world?
I guess. Or just that he's not the Green Arrow.
Or Connor Hawke is the Green Arrow.
Yeah. I mean, technically at this point, they do have their own Green Arrow in their universe. And it's just really, really bad. But that's beside the point.
Wow. Wow.
I'm pissed.
Man, there's like a lot of salt being tossed around.
Okay, I found another character we can push.
Look, you already killed it with Kangaroa.
Orca.
Morgana Le Fay?
No, Orca.
Oh.
God, the obscurity.
That's a fun character.
Orca's coming
to shit post right in the group tomorrow.
Orca's coming back to Nightwing or to Bloodhaven.
Fuck off, DC.
They're bringing back Orca, Stallion, Dwarf Devil, and Gids.
Wait. Well, Daredevil?
Thrill Devil.
Oh, no, you know Daredevil. What? I'm sorry. Nope. His name is now Daredevil forever.
I'm imagining the Daredevil theme, but with a door. And it's
I don't understand what you just said, but okay.
Not at the end, when it shows Daredevil, but I'm imagining a door.
Just Daredevil. Fucking still out of a door.
Daredevil is just the DC ripoff of Daredevil, and he just busts through doors all day.
Yeah.
Just goes up and down neighborhoods, kicking people's doors.
Yep.
Gets the end of the block, he's like, justice has been served.
Yeah. I mean, I just described Captain America, but still. God. I don't know, like, does anybody have anything, like, other than Angry Cisco, anything that they, like, really didn't like?
Not really. Like, probably the standout of three of the four shows, because I guess...
I have a plot hole for you guys.
Oh, boy.
In Supergirl, a couple episodes ago with Linda Carter, I assume that she was a Dominator, like an alien of some sort, because her, like, eyes or whatever, like, went all funky.
Right.
But she's not in this...
Right.
Earth. She's on Earth 38.
Right.
So... Does the Dominator's on both Earths?
I don't think she's the Dominator. I think she's just...
Just found a plot hole in your own theory.
I think she's just rando alien. I do think that was set up for, we're going to see the Dominators on Supergirl at some point.
You know what my favorite part of this crossover was?
What?
When they showed the vigilante again.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck off. Like, that's like the, like, 2 seconds... And then Flash comes in, and he's like, oh, okay, so, like, that's your takeaway from the whole episode.
Yeah, because...
It actually... best entrance, though, for the...
Vigilante's fucking cool.
It was actually a,
I'll agree with you there, but I mean, like, it didn't need to be.
I know, but, like, he was there.
It was... I like that, because it shows that, like, this kind of interrupted their... kind of
They're actively hunting.
Yeah.
Well, it shows a, remember in the first crossover, Flash vs. Arrow, Roy G. Bobolo whammy that cop, and Oliver was like, I heard the dispatch on the radio, and thought he'd come down, see, watch you make your move.
Right.
Flash basically said something along those lines to Oliver.
Yeah. He does. But yeah, like, for all these crossovers, as far as Flash interrupting Oliver, this is probably, I think this is the third best. I think the best one is still when he comes in during the Captain Boomerang fight, and the music swells and he catches the boomerangs. That's probably his best entrance, I'd have to say.
Yeah, but... Vigilante.
He's never talked about that.
Hunter, your attachment to seemingly shitty characters is very puzzling.
Dude, The Vigilante.
Yeah, it's
cool,
like
though.
Me and League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Yeah,
but that's but that's genuinely horrible, and we all know it.
No, but the Vigilante.
Vigilante isn't.
Yeah,
wasn't. Vigilante is endearing in like a weird G.I. Joe sense.
He's the Punisher, but like wearing ski clothes.
I have this theory that Arrow this season is just ripping off.
It's Netflix.
They're just ripping it off piece by piece. So if the next big arc is us finding out that Felicity was assaulted, let's say, by Damian Dark last year, then we'll know that they are truly just stealing Marvel Netflix storylines.
So what? Oh, never mind. I don't know. There's not much I want really left to talk about.
Yeah, we are kind of like, okay, well, do we keep on going?
Well, there is one thing that I want to say. So, events like these are the only time where it seems that Stephen Amell looks like he's having fun.
Yeah. He doesn't really get to do that.
Like, he's a better actor.
I think so.
Yeah, I have always maintained that when the Arrow crew shows up on Flash, they all give great performances.
Yeah.
The one part where he was just kind of, like, iffy to me was, like, whenever he's talking to his dad, he was all very, like, Mark Wahlberg in The Happening, where he's like, no.
Wait, like, everything's a question, and everything's puzzling, and I don't understand what's happening.
Yeah, it's funny, because he's just... He's trying to be, like, softer, and it's not working, because, like...
I'm Mark Wahlberg, I'm a teacher, believe it.
Dad, you're alive!
Dad, you're alive, oh my god!
It's weird, because that's just his natural voice. Like, Flashback Oliver...
Mark Wahlberg or Stephen Amell?
Stephen Amell, like, that's just how Stephen Amell is. Like, if you ever listen to him in interviews, that's just Stephen Amell.
I know, and I love that about him. Like, he's just
who he is.
He's just like he's in awe all the time, and it was just kind of weird, like jarring, because he's like.
So, well, the other thing is like for Stephen Amell, I guess specifically, like he does get to have a whole week or a few weeks where he gets to work with a bunch of people who started on his show, mm-hmm. and then were moved on to bigger things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It is like a class reunion probably for him. Probably even for Grant Gustin because Martin Stein, Jax, Rory.
Rory.
Yeah, they all sort of started.
Oh my god. Oh my god. I just remembered something from the crossover episode.
Was it Vigilante?
No, it wasn't. Thank God. It was Flash asking Rory, like, where Snart was.
Oh, yeah.
And it was, like, the most awkward, sad, like,
well,
Snart sacrificed himself
kind of
to save us. And I'm like, oh, Barry, no. Don't cry. You're making me cry.
Yeah.
And that kind of made me realize, like, they're really pushing, like, Flash has a relationship with the Rogues. Like,
yeah.
they're not just villains.
They're not just villains. They're his friends.
Yeah, like, they have mutual respect.
Well, specifically the Snart.
Yeah, that was what Geoff Johns did in his Wally West run of The Flash in the early 2000s.
And that's always been my favorite part of, like, the Flash villains, is that, like, they're all friends. Like, they go to the same barber, and, like, they hang out, and, like...
The Rogues have their own bar.
Really cool.
The Rogues basically killed, in the comics, when... Bart Allen was the Flash. Inertia killed him, and the Rogues let it happen. So they took it upon themselves during Rogues Rebellion, during Final Crisis, to kill Inertia, and they leave a note with his body saying, "Tell the Flash we're even."
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
well, in the Injustice comics, Superman brutally kills all the Rogues, so ha!
I did not know that.
Well, whatever. It's not a good comic.
I mean, you can put...
Damn.
We're talking really... about Injustice, by the way, at some point. I just want to get this out here now, that if Injustice 2 does not have an equally ridiculous comic, I'm going to be upset.
Well,
I mean, let's just end the show with this little mini conversation because I mean we're done with the crossover. I mean, this is Injustice is essentially one big crossover anyway.
Well, speaking of the crossovers,
The Injustice Quiet, game Alan. Is fantastic. The Injustice comic is one of the most frustrating reads I've ever had to endure, and I'm glad it's basically over.
Now, did NetherRealm have any hand in the comics?
I don't think so.
No, that was DC.
Okay, because it feels like they're trying to be like, oh, this is so edgy, we're Mortal Kombat.
No, it's DC not. It's like Superman's body count, by the end of the series, I think is in the hundreds.
Yeah, it's murders.
Ridiculous. He beats Oliver Queen to death while Mom and Pop Kent are begging him to stop. He murders Laurel while she's pregnant, I'm pretty sure.
He kills Lois Lane while she's pregnant, but that was the whole thing.
That was an accident. That was the whole cause of the whole.
He roasts 200 civilians. He kills a Joker. Whatever.
It's basically irredeemable.
Does he do what he does to Shazam in the game in the comics, where he burns a hole through his head with his laser vision?
Well, the comics lead up to the game. They take place before.
Okay.
So Shazam's still around, but he goes into a building full of I guess Joker sympathizers who are basically all they're civilians organized, and he goes in and burns them all with his heat vision.
Yeah,
and then he has a panic attack the rest of the series because someone's threatening to expose that footage, and then you're reading, you're like, okay, so this has to end with them exposing Superman, and then they don't, and it just ends, and basically everyone's dead, and then the game picks up. It sucked.
But
it's a 5-year storyline.
Here's what I loved about it.
Well, a 5-year storyline in about 2-3 years.
Here's what I loved about it, though. It does not try to be anything that this is what we are. We're sticking to this. We're not going to,
Yeah, it's full. If you want to see superheroes die dumb and violent deaths, Injustice is for you.
I seriously believe Zack Snyder read this before Batman vs Superman, and is like, I need to do that.
Nightwing dies by tripping over a rock. I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
Okay.
It wasn't the rock, right?
No. Important
to note that it was Dick Grayson who died by tripping over a rock.
Yes.
And then someone else.
But it wasn't Dwayne Johnson that killed him.
Becomes Nightwing.
No, I don't think you can trip over the rock. I think you'd see him wherever he is.
I think the rock trips you.
Good night, everybody.
Alright.
Well, wait, before we go, Tom Taylor, who wrote most of the Injustice comic, who's also returning to write the sequel comic, he also wrote part of the DC Universe Online prequel comic.
There's a prequel comic for that?
Yeah.
Well, that's a comic I'll have to avoid.
Yeah, let's say Marv Wolfman worked on it. It's not good.
All right, final thoughts, anybody?
No, I don't think I got anything. I think we're good. Chris, you want to take us out?
Of course. Like always, don't forget to send your emails to zonersgroup@gmail.com. That's zonersgroup@gmail.com. We'll read them at some point when, I don't know, someone actually emails us. And then don't forget to join our Facebook group, The Phantom Zone, on Facebook. It should pop right up when you type it in the search bar. Until next time, Excelsior!